kneel at his throne.
It's Torah talk.
Kneel at his throne.
It's Torah talk.
Kneel at his throne.
It's Torah talk.
Kneel.
It's Torah talk.
What is my name? What is my son's name?
It's Torah Talk.
We are witnesses and watchmen of Torah.
Welcome to Torah Talk, a Torah Institute podcast.
Torah just means instruction in Hebrew. At Torah Talk, we will make straight the ways of Yahuwah and discuss the simple truths of Scripture so that even you can understand and get all the juicy life hidden within the pages of Yahuwah's Torah. Welcome to Torah Talk with Lew White and Mark Davidson.
It's the Torah Zone.
Hey, brother, how are you?
Hello. Oh, that's nice.
How you been,
good
bud?
Connection. Been fine. I've been resting all Sabbath. It looks like a good connection.
Yeah. It's not bad at all.
Yeah.
I seem to have a little bit of an echo on your end. It'll fix itself up.
Yeah, as long as I don't start fading in and out. So how's the family?
Yeah, wonderful. Sorry I'm a bit late. It's just getting everybody organized, getting them some breakfast. And
wow.
Oh, yeah. It's
well, nice. I was just working on some flashcards.
Yeah.
Oh, just a two or three. I fixed this one up.
Yeah.
Riddle. That's a funny thing.
Charade. Hold up again.
Oh, riddle.
Charade, closed book, mystery, puzzle.
Yes.
The Riddler.
That's, yeah, the Riddler. So what do you want to start up with today?
Well, I'm just starting to put together the DVDs, the video footage of them, and I thought it'd be nice to pan in close to you as the very first thing anybody sees, saying, welcome to the DVD set. This is what we're doing here. And we've got everything put in one place, so it's easy for you to find and all that sort of thing. And then we'll just go into briefly what eschaton means and why we call it that.
So the opening is basically me going, I'm going to be introducing the eschaton idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So you can do a couple of takes of that if you like. Face the camera and say, g'day.
Okay. Well, hello. Hello there. My name is Lew White, and I've got the assistant here, Mark Davidson, that's been you know, a wonderful addition to this whole panoramic view of the end times. And the idea of the eschaton, is a new project that Mark was given by Yahusha to deliver a message through a package of DVDs that would explain the end days, the end of time, or the end of days. Eschaton is a word that is based on a Greek word that means the final days, the last days, the end times. And all of these things that we've been enduring over the centuries, all the revisionism and incorporating paganism into the faith, and all of these things that we see fulfilling prophecy, both good and bad, are all leading up to the last days, when we all come to our senses and say, wait a minute, this is the last days, because we have all this evidence. And it says in Acts 3 that, you know, that Yahusha is going to stay away until the restoration of all things. And the restoration would include the primary two things that we always focus on: his name, restoring his name, and restoring his word, which is his Torah. And these two things are happening. So the restoration is a fulfilling of prophecy. And we're all witnessing that. So what we'd like to do is to begin with just introducing the idea of the eschaton and the 4-CD package that it will embody to explain all the little details and all the strongholds that have to be overcome. You know, because a lot of people are misprogrammed with false reasonings, what we should do, what we should not do. Some people won't dance. Some people won't drink. Some people won't eat meat. There's all sorts of fear. And we have to find out what pleases Yahuwah. And what pleases him is not men's traditions, but rather the obedience to his commandments. This is the goal of all men, to obey the commandments of Elohim. And we'd like to introduce him to you in a series of DVDs, introducing his name and his Torah. And we're going to go about that, you know, in a way that is comprehensible, that you can understand and follow. And it's for every man and every woman. It's not, you don't have to be a scholar. We're going to show you what's happened and what is expected. I don't know if that's going to be good enough, but, you know.
That's wonderful, brother. You bring up a good point. We should probably, we deal with the name and the covenant and immersion and everything in a different set of DVDs, but for somebody who's just picked up this set, we should probably state up front, like you do at your seminars, we don't use JESUS or GOD or the common names you've probably heard about the Creator. You're probably wondering, why Yahuwah? You know, yeah. What's that about? So,
yeah.
We,
yes. That's true. Mm-hmm. Well, how do you want to start out that then? We'll have to show it on a chart, I guess. Let's see.
Well, I'll put up one of your seminar slides as far as you, and you can just, in fact, if you want to save time, I'll just cut to one of, because you do it every seminar, I'll cut to one of you. We're going to cut right now to Lew explaining why we're doing, using the terms that we're using. And he explains this at every single seminar so that people who are new or don't understand the terms can understand why we're using apparently foreign terms. But it's actually his name. And it's a very precious thing.
Yeah. All right. Well, you want to start with any other details?
I also liked the idea when you said, when we were getting ideas to put this together, you were saying it's not about what we should expect to happen. It's about what the Creator Yahuwah expects
of us.
I hadn't thought of it like that before. That's really amazing.
Yeah, that's what we see everybody doing. They're creating charts and timelines, and they're trying to explain what's coming and what's ahead and what's already happened and what's going to be happening and how many years it's going to take before that happens and who everybody is. you know, like we're able to keep track of that, you know, like the person, the people that are of a certain nationality are not who they seem to be. You know, there's the people that say those people aren't really who they say they are. And then there's the people that say, it's really us. And then there's the people that say, oh, it's only the black people or it's only the white people. It's just messed up, you know, this nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom. And, you know, we're all opposed to one another. You know, it's the one that loves that matters. I mean, the one that loves is the identification of one of his followers. And when there's arguing and disputing and rivaling and all this, you know, just incredible disputes and you're not pronouncing the name right. And, oh, it's just, there's no end to the problems. But we're all, you know, in we're all in different places in the race. The race is not a race for knowledge. It's a race to get to the love, you know. The one that wins, that gets to the end of the race, you might think it's the end of their life. It isn't the end of their life. It's reaching the goal. And the goal in Scripture is love. There it is. So when you find it, you just want everybody, you're cheering everybody into the finish line because everybody gets the same reward. We all get trophies, you know. We're not great. Yeah. We're not in an Olympic Games.
Yeah, yeah. That's relevant this year.
Yeah, yeah. Where are they having that this year?
London, I think.
Is it? Oh.
I think it's London.
Yeah, some have said that the word London was around before history, really. It was an ancient name for that city. It was a port city, and it was actually one that was established by some lost tribes of Dan, which gives it its name, London, the abode of Dan. Because even back during the Roman Empire, London was something that the Romans discovered. They didn't found it. It was already there. Yeah.
Wow.
The abode of Dan.
When we were when we were studying years ago, and we had this big thick book we read about Revelation and everything, and I think in there somewhere it said, I don't know if this is where it came from, some place in my head, but Proton is the first coming and Eschaton is the second coming, isn't it? Have you heard that, or is that just messed up?
Well, that would make sense because of the use of the words in the Greek. Yes, that would fit, certainly. And then eschaton would be the second. No, not really. The words, the idea of second coming isn't there. But it is true that that's when it is. But the second coming is during the last day. So, in fact, it's the goal. It's really the last days represent the events of the distress and all the things that happen that lead up to his return. And then when his return comes, a new beginning starts. So his second coming is really not an ending. It's a beginning. Mm. So you have the millennium that begins, and that's not the end times. Mm. That's actually the beginning. And it's great.
Also, when we were... even after we'd become Nazarim, when we were still gathered together, we started studying Revelation again at one point, and our teachers thought to take out all the chapters and verses of Revelation, and it seems a bit more like it was a dream, like it was a vision, which it was. Would you sort of go along with that sort of thing? How do you attempt to, books like Daniel or Revelation or things like that, how do you attempt to... understand them? And I know on the broad sense we don't really understand anything, but it's how would you attempt to sort of understand that for yourself personally, and like you don't like to do to map it out, but would you take the verses and chapters out, or would you just sort of...
Yeah, so that would be the thing to do, is don't stop at the end of a chapter, but look at the chapters as if they're fluid and there's no barriers. One of the best examples for anybody to look at would be Revelation chapter 13 and Revelation chapter 14, the reason there's so much mystery is because this line is blocked. This wall has been put up between those two chapters. But if you keep reading all the way through without that barrier, there's a comparison given between the mark of the beast and the mark of Yahuwah and his name, the beast's name and Yahuwah's name. And it's very, very easy to see this. So there's a distinction being made between the names. And that's why the riddles are unsolvable for the most part. See, a riddle is like a charade. It's like a, you know, when you represent something that represent, you're showing somebody something that represents something else, you see. And that's why it's you get the idea of a closed book. You know, Daniel was told to close the book to, because this is a something that will not be revealed until the end times, and the end times are upon us. So now we're seeing a linkage between the book of Daniel and Revelation. And the mystery is being solved, and the secret of Elohim is being unfolded. Samson had a riddle one time. Remember, he was negotiating with his enemies over, or not his enemies, it was over the wedding clothes, yeah. He was wanting to them to give them him so much if they could solve a riddle for him. And the riddle was something like, out of the eater, something to eat, and out of the strong, something sweet. You know, this was a riddle, and they couldn't solve it, you know, until, you know, finally somebody tricked him into, you know, one of his girlfriends tricked him into revealing the meaning of the riddle. But we are seeing a lot of these things basically unfolding, and the truth is getting out, because the barriers of the chapters, yeah, you're absolutely right. Those are basically put there, I think, to deceive us, you know. But it was probably not there to, you know, I mean, I'm not saying the evil one did it. It's just something that was part of the closing of the book, so people's minds would be closed. Mm. And, you know, we're now opening them back up. Mm. But the things that are symbolic of other things are very difficult for people to understand. You know, like the wheat and the tares, you know, those are symbols. It's not literal wheat or literal weeds. They're people, you know, and identifying them. And it could be applied to doctrines. The wheat could be doctrines and the weeds could be bad doctrines, you know. Mm. So they have more than one level of understanding too. Mm. The image and the name and the number, those are all symbolic as well, you know. And they are also literal. They can have literal and figurative levels.
Mm. So the important thing is to not build up a wall and say, this is what it means, and I've decided that's what it means. I'm not going to believe anything else, because, as you've said before, when we were talking about the 144,000 things, it could be literal. It could also mean something else entirely different, because we didn't write it, and it's not really for us to understand. It's just for us to be obedient and ready, isn't it?
Well, most likely it is literal, though. But it's not up for us to identify who they are. We're not keeping track. The books, the books that are recorded in the heavens, are not for us to read or know now or figure out now. These are things that are identified later in time, and when those names are read out of the book of life or the book of remembrance, we have only the sovereignty of Yahuwah that can determine those things. And we're usurping his sovereignty when we try to second guess with, you know, to identify people or groups of people. So what we try to do is just, that's outside our bounds anyway. It's not anything we were ever told to figure out, you know. But, you know, it is interesting, though, that it's written down. It's sort of there on display, so that he watches what we do with and how we act around. Because when we put ourselves above other people and exalt ourselves and try to judge other people, then we're out of bounds, you know, because we're the one that wants to be in charge of a flock should be the servant of the people, not the not to put them up and to, you know, use them to devour them and eat off of them, but to help them comprehend what they should do and how to prepare for his coming, not to figure out when he's coming, but to prepare for his coming. Because like you were saying, you know, it's a matter of us figuring out what it is we have to do to prepare rather than try to figure out when it's going to happen. Otherwise, we just sit back and go, well, it's going to be another 1,000 years. We don't have to worry about anything. That'll be another generation. But believe it or not, what we do as individuals can have incredible effects. I mean, look at what our beloved brother Paul did. He was just one guy, and he did it while he was wearing chains around the Roman soldiers. And, yeah, that's amazing. He was placed in a specific, in a strategic place to perform a certain thing, to write letters to individual assemblies. You know, look what it's done. It's also become a huge controversy.
Yeah, you mentioned Paul, and you also mentioned before about when the chapters were put in that it wasn't so much deception, but it's getting in the way. The people who put the canon together, who I think were, that was part of Catholicism, wasn't it? The people who put the canon together. What for you determines whether a book has validity and whether it was, because there's other books that aren't in the canon, that should be apparently, and there's books that are in the canon that shouldn't be apparently. So what do you, what inside you makes you put reliance on what somebody in the canon writes down, and what would make you look outside and say, oh, well, that, you just have to trust the spirit within you? Or,
well, yeah, that's certainly true. However, when you see a book that's in the canon that's an eyewitness of Yahushua, and that's not necessarily, to me, it, now the, to the circus, that was one of the prerequisite things. In the Brith Kadoshah, or what they call the New Testament writings, you had to be a witness of Messiah. You had to have seen him in order for you to have your writings to have validity and to be included. But it's not necessarily the way it is. I mean, he can speak and through anyone, but, you know, and I've always been excited to think maybe one day we'll discover a book that he wrote, you know, but he really did write them all, you know, because he's in the people doing the writing. After Acts chapter 2, that event, he indwelled the Nazarene, as he does now, and it has throughout all time. And by indwelling them, he guided them to say and write what he told them to write. Now, in terms of the mentioning of other prophets, like, for example, in the book of Yehuda or Jude, one of the, I think it's the second last book in the order in most translations, the book, the man who was the half-brother of Yahusha, Jude or Yehuda, he actually mentions and quotes from Enoch or Hanak, the man who lived before the flood. Now, where's the books of Enoch? You know, well, they're in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and there are several other books, and even in the Tanakh, there's references and questions. Is it not written in the such and such? And, you know, and these other reference books are not included in the Tanakh, and yet they're pointing to them as validation or verification of what it's saying. So that's amazing. Yeah. Hmm. I mean, that's a whole study of itself. And yeah. But as far as validity, yes, when you're reading the word and it's alive, you know, you can feel the spirit in you confirming it, you know, responding to it. Hmm. There's an affirmation with your spirit, the spirit that he's given you in you, that this is very true because it all lines up with his will. If it doesn't line up with his will, then it's incongruous. Mm-hmm. You know, people say that the writing of the scriptures conflicts with itself. Well, no, it doesn't. It actually, in terms of those are human misunderstandings and translational errors, but in essence, the word does not conflict with itself. It doesn't say you can't eat pigs and then later say, yes, you can. See, it does not do that. And that Mark 7 error was where some misguided monk somewhere wrote into the borders or the edges of the scroll, he thus declared all foods clean. And someone later on brought that into the text, you know, for the NIV, you know. But those are errors.
Wow.
See, so it doesn't conflict. It doesn't say you can't do this and now you can. You know, that's just not right. You know, it's very, very clear. So
I know a lot of people have looked at the source of the compiling of the canon and said, oh, well, that's who put it together, so that, you know, we don't have to trust in all these books. We don't have to, they're just basically ripping apart the validity of our scriptures because of who put them together, apparently. But I was once told that I think if you have a love for the truth, Yahushua wouldn't allow us to be deceived by his own, well, it's not his canon, but by his own writings, even if there were a couple of things left out, or, you know, would he? It's man's traditions that deceive us and the enemy. It's not so much the scriptures themselves, although translations have caused troubles and put bits in where they don't belong. But I think if we have a love for the truth, I think the validity of the canon still stands, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And when copies were made into Greek, copy after copy after copy, there were sentences and words and things like that left out by the copyists. I mean, maybe they had to stop and go eat some dinner, and then they came back and they picked up in the wrong spot. We don't know. Or maybe some of these things were removed because they didn't really align with the circus doctrines. You know, they say, oh, we don't want to put that in there. But, you know, but yet enough made it through that we can still confirm that these are all affirming the will of Yahuwah. It's like the typos in my books. I mean, they're typos.
Well, that's amazing, brother. So, between here and the consolidation of global powers, which is what's happening now, there's a lot of scriptural books that deal with the actual system that we now live in, and they prophesy the system that we live in, the different beasts that are in the systems that are in the statue, the big statue and everything. So I thought, before we actually get to today and what's happening and what Satan's doing, consolidating everything, we should probably lay a bit of a foundation on what the fourth beast is and what the beast systems are and why we're living in one.
That's a good idea. And also, if we have time, at the end of this seminar, I've got a New World essay that's written by some unknown author. Have you seen that?
I think I have. Is that the one that talks about the FEMA camps and what's planning? And
yes. Yeah. Yes. The New World Order essay is what it's called. And interestingly enough, right at the very last page, or nearly the last page, it says that the next phase is manipulated chaos of the New World Order, and its plan is a continuous war in the Middle East, followed by an engineered collapse of the North American economy. This is happening now. We all see it happening here. They're engineering the collapse of the economy by enacting things like the health care, affordable health care, you know, which is a huge tax, and destroying the job creators. And America is about to become a fully fascist state with martial law because of the fact that the people are going to rise up, and there's going to be terrorism. You know, they're going to say, okay, that's it. And they're going to clamp down on their own population. They've actually got fully operational internment concentration camps that are ready to be put into full use right now. And a North American Union or treaty is about to be established from the ruins. And increasingly destructive staged terror attacks are distinct possibilities in the near future because of the the way that the government, which is a very small thug group, I mean, they're like gangs that run the nations. We're the country is the neighborhood, and there's a gang that's taken over the neighborhood, and they're forcing everybody to pay them and make them comfortable at the expense of the rest of the neighborhood. And that's the country, and that's what's really happening. And the populations of a nation never went to war with another population. It was always the gangs in control that were fighting the other gangs. And that's why the population gets drawn into it. And that's what's really happening. It's manipulated chaos. Mm. That's happening.
Mm. So it's not really about looking at one man at the top and going, oh, it's his fault. He could just be kicked out and another one come in, it'd be worse, couldn't it?
Yeah, the armed forces and the government, our legislative branch, judicial branch, and executive branch are all there to preserve themselves, as is any other government. They all exist to preserve their own power. And when the population is in disagreement with them, they attack their own population. That's what will happen. But, it's just amazing to watch. And actually, it's like a cartel. They take over. It's like some drug cartel that just comes in, takes over certain key positions, and then they run the whole show. And they eliminate everybody real quick that's in opposition to them. You know, assassination or just, counting them out of the possibilities. And they put their own guys in for the two people. Both the people they're choosing from in an election are going to get the job done. It doesn't matter which one the population chooses. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is true that some people will have rigged elections too, mm-hmm. Like one side doesn't want anybody to give any kind of identification when they go to vote. Well, that's all part of it too. Manipulated chaos, Anyway, what do you want to start with? What's the next?
Where would you like to be sitting today, brother, dealing with the fourth beast? What, behind, in front of a Washington Monument or a dollar bill or where would you like to be sitting today? Is there that big thing of Abraham Lincoln? Where's that?
Yeah, there is a picture of that. Well, I don't know. Let's think about those things, though. We can certainly use some of that, yeah. But identifying the fourth beast would probably be the most important thing we could do. And what a beast is, you have to define what a beast is scripturally. A beast in Scripture is first encountered in the book of Daniel. And we're going to look for that. But there's other words, like code words, that are used for the same entity. The anti-Mashiach and his coterie or crowd, the false prophet and the little horn, all refer to the fourth beast, or attributes of the fourth beast. And I guess we could start with Abraham Lincoln's quote. Abraham Lincoln spoke a word of warning to the future generations of the United States. Abraham Lincoln was the president during the 1860s, and he said the following words, knowing how the Jesuits, this is a cartel that's within the Catholic circus, plotted his own death. Now, this is his words. Quote, "I do not pretend to be a prophet, but though not a prophet, I see a very dark cloud on our horizon, and that dark cloud is coming from Rome. A cyclone such as the world has never seen will pass over this country, spreading ruin and desolation from north to south. Neither I nor you, but our children will see those things." Far beyond the plot that he knew was being laid to kill him, he could sense from the Jesuits that they were fixed on overtaking the United States. That's the Jesuits were fixed to overtake the United States by some means from within. He sensed the rise of the United Nations, which is an agency of the Jesuits, and it's set up to rule the whole world.
Hmm.
Now,
I found after going through, because this fourth beast study that you put together was one of the first things I read, or a documentary we made when I first sort of met you. And I found after going through this study, everything after this, like things that float around the internet, people are like, oh, look, look what we found. Look what they're doing. Look at that eye there. And look at the, you know, the pyramid. And look at the Illuminati. And look at the knights. And look at all this stuff. I found that all so boring after reading you. I found that your study went straight to the point, explained what the whole thing's doing. So I understood. And then I moved on to something else. And then some people just make it their life journey to study the evil. And I find the evil kind of, once you know it and you face what it is, yeah, let's get on with it. I know we're dealing with it today and explaining it, but it's just all, it's all been consolidated into the Jesuits now, hasn't it?
Really? Yes, it has. In fact, they've been consolidating their power for centuries.
Hmm.
The New World Order is actually the old world order that they've been trying to rebuild since Rome fell. The new Roman Empire, the Holy Roman Empire, was a resurrection of that. And the Knights Templars, which were priest monks, were a very important part of the power structure all over Europe with that. The Knights Templar were, you know, wore these white tunics with a big red crux across the top. And they were monks and they were also knights. So they were priests, not warriors. And they were bilking people out of their money to go see dead St. Ralph's thumb or something far off in the distance through the woods. And they'd say, well, yeah, I'd like to go see the dead Ralph's thumb. Yeah, and his cloak is there as well. And then they would say, well, yeah, there's power in those thumbs and those cloaks. And if you go there, you will be imbued or endowed with special grace. And maybe a lot of your time in purgatory will be forgiven you. So these people that were wealthy, like nobility and, you know, princes, would pay them this money to take them on these little journeys, like in Canterbury Tales, you know, Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. They were on their way to go see something. And in the little troop, there would be different people. Mm-hmm. And Chaucer's Canterbury Tales is all about that. Mm-hmm. And anyway, they go through there, and those are the Knights Templars. And they got amassed all this money, and then eventually they had so much that the nobility had to go to them to get money, to get loans for things. And they became bankers. And then the nobility decided to turn on them. And they had cooperation from the papacy to execute them. And they killed all of them except for the ones in Scotland. And the ones that were in Scotland, you know, shuddered with fear, and they said, well, we can't be calling ourselves that anymore. So they continued to think of themselves as knights, but they changed their name, and they started this little organization that we know today as Masonry, the Masons of the Scottish Rite, you know, the Scottish Rite, you know, and they had different levels of knighthood, you know, 32 degrees. Well, anyway, the 33rd degree was the Illuminati level, and the Society of Esu did not pop up until later, but they were actually the same people, the same organizational people, but of course they were centuries later. But Manly P. Hall, a 33rd degree, wrote these words in a text called The Lost Keys of Freemasonry, or The Secret of Hiram Abiff. The day has come when fellow craftsmen must know and apply their knowledge. The lost key to their grade is the master of emotion, which places the energy of the universe at their disposal. Man can only expect to be entrusted with great power by proving his ability to use it constructively and selflessly. When the Mason learns that the key to the warrior on the block is the proper application of the dynamo of living power, he has learned the mystery of his craft. The seething energies of Lucifer are in his hands, and before he may step onward and upward, he must prove his ability to properly apply energy. He must follow in the footsteps of his forefather, Tubal-Cain, who with the mighty strength of the war god hammered his sword into a plowshare. Well, anyway, this is all just part of a book that embodies the Mason's inner secrets. Anyway, they call themselves the Adepts, you know, and they use symbols. They use a lot of symbols, you know, like the eye of H-O-R-U-S was used by the Egyptians, and the Masons always appeal back to that ancient culture. And they call themselves the Adepts, and they're preparing the world for the arrival of the anti-Messiah through the symbols. The symbols are all to prepare the world for the arrival of the anti-Messiah. The feature that stands out above all others is the all-seeing eye. The blazing star, now this is another one. This is one of the headmasters or the one of the what do they call the title of the Freemasons? The Grand Master. Albert Pike, in his book Morals and Dogma, on page 26, mentions this. The blazing star has been regarded as an emblem of omniscience, or the all-seeing eye, which to the Egyptian initiates was the emblem of Osiris, the creator, unquote. Now, there he is. He's referring to this as the central symbol. The creator's symbol is being the blazing star, the eye. And that when you look at the blazing star of the Masons, on the top of the pyramid, on the dollar bill of the United States, for example, which was a design that was created by Adam Weishaupt, actually, in the 1770s, but he was a Jesuit. But the blazing star has this glow around it, like it's a blazing, you know. And, of course, other symbols around the world have been seen with an eye, like the CBS, Columbia Broadcasting Network, has an eye. And the entire world has been basically planned out in 10 sections or 10 sectors with the blazing eye on one of the coins that they cast. But in the prophet Isaiah, or Yeshayahu, chapter 14, starting at verse 12, it says, "How have you fallen from the heavens, O Hillel, son of the morning? You have been cut down to the ground, you who laid low the Gentiles. For you have said in your heart, let me go up to the heavens. Let me raise my throne above the stars of El. And let me sit in the mount of meeting on the sides of the north. Let me go up above the heights of the clouds. Let me be like the Most High." So he's actually an imitator, and he's actually becoming an identity thief. He's already succeeded so much at tricking people into thinking that he is the creator. He's even stolen the words of Yahuwah by inserting the word L-O-R-D, or Lord, into the text, because that word translates directly into the Hebrew word B-A-A-L. The Prince of Darkness, you know. He seeks to be like Yahuwah. Mm-hmm. Now, let's see. Now, the four beasts that are mentioned in Daniel are very important to identify. Most all the religious cultures that follow Christianity have identified them properly. And it's impossible to make a mistake, really. Babel was the first, the head, because it's identified in there, in the scriptures, as being the head. So Babel, or Babylon. And then the next one that succeeded Babylon is Medo-Persia, which is represented by the arms of silver. And then the third one is Greece, and that's symbolized by the brass of the thighs and the waist. Now, the last one is Rome, which split into two parts, hence the two legs of iron. Now, in the schism of 1054, the Eastern Orthodox Catholic basically split away from the Roman Catholic West. So the East and the West split, and they became the two legs of what we call Rome, and they considered themselves to be the Holy Roman Empire. That was actually, that started around 800 with Charlemagne, and it continued on. basically all the way up until 1054, and it continued even beyond that because they still considered themselves the Holy Roman Empire. Only they were just split into two legs. So anyway, Rome received this deadly wound in 476 when it ended because the capital of Rome, well, it was actually called Roma, it actually fell because of inner corruption and bad morality, and the family unit was disintegrating, as is the family unit in many countries now, especially the United States. But the fact is, Constantine, who changed the Sabbath to Sunday, basically in honor of the deity of the sun, that's what he did it for. He did this other thing that's catastrophic. He moved the capital of Rome to what he called Constantinople. So it developed two capitals. Rome had all the roads led to Rome, but none of the roads led to Constantinople. So it was impossible after the capital moved for it to enforce any of its laws. So the city of Rome fell into the hands of all the, you know, ravaging tribes and, you know, basically barbarians took over. But the cities developed into two geopolitical powers, becoming the centers of the Roman Catholic West and the Eastern Orthodox Catholic Constantinople. Anyway, symbols, other symbols that we have other than the eye, is the symbol of ancient Rome, which involved SPQR, those letters, which we can show on the screen, and the wreath around it, which, you know, is the symbol of the authoritarian, tyrannical authority of world rule of the Caesar, because he considered himself the ruler of the world. That's why it's on the flag of the United Nations, because they think they want, their objective is to rule the world. It's right there on their emblem, because it means the ruler of the world. That's what the Caesar symbol meant, that wreath. Now, the SPQR stands for Senatus Populusque Romanus, the Senate and People of Rome. And during the regime of Benito Mussolini, the SPQR was emblazoned on a number of public buildings and manhole covers in an attempt to promote his dictatorship as the new Roman Empire. See, the objective has always been to rule the world, you know, and it had to start from somewhere. And other symbols of the Roman Empire can be seen in the city of Reggio Emilia in northern Italy. There's a coat of arms there with that same thing. It's got the Knights Templar background and the shield. It's got the wreath. It has the SPQR. And, you know, it's all right there. And it's a symbol of authority and power. Then we have this chariot of the sun that's above the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, in Germany, and we can show that to them too. This chariot of the sun has a deity that they've named V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, riding in her chariot, holding up Roman standards like the eagle, the cross, and the wreath. And these are not Christian symbols. These are sun worship symbols. And then another symbol, which a lot of people don't know about, the fasces, where we get fascism from, which is a bundle of rods. And this bundle of rods is held together, usually with red ribbons, and it's a symbol of strength through unity. And in other words, even in Scripture, it talks about, you know, a three-cord rope that is not easily broken. And a lot of examples were given in teaching young children that if you bend one stick and break it, it's easy to do. But when you get more and more sticks, it becomes harder to break, you know. Anyway, in the United States, in Washington, D.C., there's a Lincoln Memorial that Lincoln would be absolutely traumatized to see if he saw this. He would just break down. He would not be happy, because this man's heart was not anything like what we see in this picture. But this thing is in a temple, and he's sitting in Caesar's throne with the fasci, which is the plural of fasces. So you've got him right there in front of you looking at him. He would never have thought of himself as a deity, which is what Caesars thought they were. Because, see, governments ultimately, when they get more and more and more power, they ultimately do demand worship. And that's why we're seeing this transition in certain places, that you have to become a worshiper, because they actually are trying to shun any other religions other than their own secularism and their humanism, so that they will blaze out there and be the main event, because all these other religions are just competing with them. So they're more and more moving to outlaw them. But anyway, HaShatan, or Satan's seat of power, reigns over the fourth beast. Where is Babel's head today? Well, Babel is still going on. See, Babylon didn't end, and Medo-Persia really didn't end, and Greece never ended. It's all been incorporated into this beast, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So all the traits of each beast previously are incorporated into the successive beast. So the second beast incorporated the first beast and new attributes, and then the first three beasts incorporated the first, second, and third altogether. And now the fourth beast incorporates the first beast, second beast, third beast, and fourth beast. So we can say that the obelisk would have been the first thing that we see in the book of Daniel as being idolatry, when they bowed down to this image. And the image of the beast was this huge monument. And this thing is preserved as the biggest monument in the world. It's called the Washington Monument. And it's the largest obelisk known to ever have existed. And it resides, obviously, at Hashatan's center of power. And it's on a lot that is numbered 666. Now, that's interesting. And we can just go into a little bit of that, too, in a little bit. But lot 666 is the name of the lot. And it's exactly 6,660 inches high. And that's thanks to the Masonic or Illuminati planners who govern the United States. And the eagle was chosen to be the United States. This is another symbol. The eagle was chosen to be the national bird for the United States, as it was for Germany and the Holy Roman Empire and the Roman Empire, and CEUS of Greece and RA of Egypt. You know, this deity of Egypt was represented anthropomorphically as an eagle. Now, there's a word you can look up on the internet. Anthropomorphic. I don't want to say that. A-H-U-R-A-M-A-Z-D-A, which means the Lord of Wisdom, in Persia. And in Assyria, where I think it was, the prophet Jonah went to Assyria and Nineveh, and their primary deity was represented by an eagle, and his name was N-I-S-R-O-C-H. And of course, going all the way back, B-A-A-L of Babylon was represented by an eagle. So it's not hard to figure out that Yahuwah is not really behind any of these things. So they're, because they're beasts. See, and the beast is not of Yahuwah. But they kept building these things, and the biggest thing, up until 1884, the highest human object was this obelisk at Washington, D.C. And the fourth beast is also called a little horn when it starts out. In Daniel 7, starting at verse 7, it says, "After this I looked in the night visions and saw a fourth beast, fearsome and burly, exceedingly strong, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and crushed and trampled down the rest with its feet. And it was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And I was thinking about the horns, and then I saw another horn, a little one, coming up among them. And three of the first horns were plucked out by the roots before it. And see, eyes like the eyes of a man were in this horn, and a mouth speaking great words." See, the objective of all governments once they get enough power, is to receive worship. The little horn happens to be the papal ruler, the anti-Mashiach, the one who's in place of the Messiah. And the Prince of Darkness controls him in another darker man. Daniel 7, verse 17, starts out saying this: "These great beasts, which are four sovereigns which rise up from the earth. Then the set-apart ones of the Most High shall receive the reign and possess the reign forever, even forever and ever. Then I desired for certainty concerning the fourth beast, which was different from all the others, very fearsome, with its teeth of iron and its nails of bronze, which devoured, crushed, and trampled down the rest with its feet. And concerning the ten horns that were on its head, and of the other horn that came up, before which three fell, this horn, which had eyes and a mouth, which spoke great words, whose appearance was greater than his fellows, I was looking, and this little horn was fighting against the set-apart ones and was prevailing against them until Atik Yomim, the Ancient of Days, came. And right ruling was given to the set-apart ones of the Most High. And the time came, and the set-apart ones took possession of the reign." That's the end of the beast. When we take over as followers of Yahushua, and by the way, it does mention that his title is Ancient of Days, he is going to take the reign. And that's the end of the beast system. So this is all basically kind of telescopic. Then it moves on and says the little horn intends to change the times and the Torah. See, now we're going to back up and go back and see what the beast has been up to. In Daniel chapter 7:23 through 7:25, it said, this is what he said: "The fourth beast is the fourth reign on the earth, which is different from all other reigns, and it devours all the earth." It's going to be a global government. "And it tramples it down and crushes it. And the ten horns are ten sovereigns." Now that's the ten sectors that they plan in the New World Order. "They shall rise, and another, the little horn, shall rise after them, and it is different from the first ones, and it humbles three sovereigns, and it speaks words against the Most High, and it wears out the set-apart ones of the Most High, and it," that's the little horn, "intends to change appointed times and Torah," or law, "and they are given into its hand for a time and times and half a time." So what do you think?
Definitely changed the times and seasons, didn't they?
Yes, they did. They eliminated the redemptive festivals. The redemptive festivals of Israel are the annual Sabbaths, and then we've got the actual weekly Sabbath that they attempted to change. Well, they tried to interrupt the week itself and make 8 days or 9 days. It was actually 8 days, I think, originally, and then there was a market day. But that fell apart. But the 7 days of the week, they went ahead and, in the year 321, Constantine proclaimed that to be changed to the first day of the week in honor of the sun. Yeah. Not the S-O-N, but the S-U-N. So, anyway, you think we ought to go into the pale horse part too?
Yeah, I'm sure the horses and all that, yeah.
Yeah, there's a little mistranslation in that, most scriptures. There's a phrase where they say that death is riding upon a pale horse. Well, in Revelation 6, starting at verse 7, it says, "And when he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature saying, 'Come and see.' And I looked and saw a pale horse." That's the mistranslated word. "And he who sat on it had the name Death. And the grave followed with him. And authority was given to them over a fourth of the earth, to kill with the sword and with hunger and with death, and by the beasts of the earth." Well, you know, I want to mention this. In that text, the word is Greek 55:15. It's the word chloros. The word chloros means green. And the word green is a code word these days for socialism, you know, but it's a way of attacking the energy sector mainly. But it has a lot of promoters coming from the governments, and because they don't like the way we're using up the resources of the world. We think we're they're injuring their mother because they worship the earth. Well, anyway, the word chlorophyll means green leaf, in case you're interested. You can look that up. That's the green part of the leaf. It's the thing that makes a leaf green, is the chlorophyll. Well, it's Greek, but here's the thing. Not so many years ago, I remember my grandfather would not eat anything green because he thought it was deadly poison. And it may be related to the fact that this scripture was known, and it was saying that maybe they knew what the word green meant. If something was green, it was bad. I don't know. But lately, Al Gore has been writing around saying, you know, people were accusing Al Gore of being the death rider. You know? Yeah. And he, being the death rider, he was the anti-messiah. But the death rider is not necessarily, you know, Al Gore. But he does want us to be very green, because he says if we don't get green, we're going to die. And he talks about that's involving death. So greenness and death are, you know, associated there. But I don't think we're going to see Al Gore being a problem. Al Green is another matter, though. He's a vocalist.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
And, yeah. Thomas Jefferson, one of the founders of our nation of the United States, he named the U.S. Capitol building, this is going to blow your mind, the Temple of Libertas, which is the equivalent of Minerva. Now, that's a deity of Rome, and that's not good. This is a woman depicted on the Capitol building at the very top. A woman, a religious figure, over a beast government. So there it is. And they do this stuff with symbols, you know. And they have this painting of Minerva, which is the same thing. It's the same female deity, collaborating with the founding fathers in the Capitol Rotunda art. Anyway, these people are deluded by this Masonic enlightenment, because the men that designed the structure or the image of the USA believed that they were adepts doing a great work. That's what they keep saying, this great work. You know, they're really following this fellow named Inigo Loyola and Adam Weishaupt, the great plan of the Jesuit Illuminati. Now, just put that together. Jesuit Illuminati, and you have it right. Don't leave out the Jesuits. When you say Illuminati, don't forget to mention the Jesuits, because that's who they are, the ones that are in control. And the Millennium Endgame is the global government that is the great plan. It's the great work, the global government. You know. Anyway, another title or code word for the anti-messiah is the man of sin. And the man of sin will one day be revealed, and he's the controlling force of lawlessness. Lawlessness means to be without instructions. In other words, you'll have men's traditions, but you will not be following Yahuwah's way or his will. Now, references to this lawless one are found in the scriptures. He's referred to as the anti-Mashiach, the false prophet, the little horn, the abomination of desolation, the man of sin, the son of perdition, the lawless one. And he's also the mystery of iniquity, or embodies it. In Revelation 17, verse 18, it says, "And the woman whom you saw is that great city, having sovereignty over the sovereigns of the earth." Now, that's interesting. The harlot woman is a usurper of the term Israel, too, because they claim to be Israel. And true Israel is the wife of Yahuwah in a marriage relationship with Yahuwah through his covenant, which is the Ten Commandments. But these people, they usurp the Ten Commandments, and then they change them. So they've altered the wedding agreement. So obviously, they're not the bride, the wife. And this harlot is a harlot because she's not serving Yahuwah, but serving other deities. That's what harlotry means, idolatry. She's very Torah-phobic. She's afraid of the instructions of Yahuwah and afraid of those that keep them, because she will hear no Torah and see no Torah and speak no Torah. Mm. Now, in the text at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 6, we understand that there's a restrainer. A lot of Christians are taught that the restrainer is the Holy Spirit. And then the restrainer is taken out of the way. Like Yahuwah is going to be run out of the world. No way. He's not going to leave. But watch this. He says he'll be with us always, you know. And the restrainer is within the harlot woman, religiously controlling the world governments. And this is the mother circus, which sits on the beast, controlling it. And it says in 2 Thessalonians 2, starting in verse 6, and now you know what restrains, and that he might be revealed in his time. In other words, we aren't. If this sentence stands as being the restrainer is the Holy Spirit, well, he's going to be revealed. That's true, but he's already being revealed. So this is something else. Now you know what restrains, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity does already work only in the restrainer. Did you see here what that says? Until he be taken out of the way. How in the world could theologians that can read and write and have high levels of doctrinal degrees read that and claim that the mystery of iniquity is operating in the restrainer and then accuse the Holy Spirit of being the restrainer? That's crazy. Anyway, let me read that again.
So you're not plugging seminary colleges here, are you?
No, I guess they're not going to like this. I'm a lying deceiver. What am I doing? What was that accusation?
Yeah, I just got this morning. Yeah,
I just got that. But
excuse me, yeah, teacher.
It was a suicide situation. Yeah. Now, for the mystery of iniquity does already work only in the restrainer until he be taken out of the way. Okay, the mystery of lawlessness is what iniquity means. Now, we know what will restrain or control the 10 economic sectors, the Illuminati. Let me just say the Jesuit Illuminati. A secret society, the Illuminati, within a secret society, the Jesuits, within Catholicism. Yeah. I mean, we need to let this take over our lives. This is not the objective of our lives. This is just information that we need to get and then walk away and say, this is it.
So I thought, when you said, if you're going to say the word Illuminati, make sure you include the word Jesuits as well. I thought these days, because every week something comes through YouTube saying, oh, don't listen to that pop star. They're controlled by Illuminati. Don't listen to that guy's music because he's got an eyeball in the background and an all-seeing eye and all this stuff. And like, we don't go Jesuit Knights Templar or Jesuit Alumbrados or Jesuit Society of JSUS. So I'm putting forward, isn't the Illuminati redundant now? Isn't that like a smokescreen to sort so people are looking there when it's really the sweet, lovely Jesuits over here who couldn't harm a soul, so we don't see them? Isn't the word Illuminati kind of irrelevant now? Don't they go underground, disappear, and then come up with a different name?
Oh, they will, yeah. But they'll maintain their old names as well. Yeah.
Okay.
It's not irrelevant, no, because they have all these little groups and organizations that they have imprinted their mark on it or their goals, you know, like the Knights Templar, that was one. And then you've got the Knights of Malta. We're going to get to a few more of their titles in a couple of frames, but Yeah. But who or what controls the papacy? Well, the restrainer is ultimately that entity. And the restrainer is behind the papacy in another man. And it's ultimately Hashatan's spirit. When it's exposed or realized that the serpent of old is the power behind the papacy, the government or kings will destroy the entire organization out of their lands. And as it has been tried in the past against Jesuitism, see, the Jesuits were suppressed and attacked and suppressed and canceled and, you know, a number of times. But the fourth beast, though, is basically this entity controlled by Satan, or, you know, the adversary. But the Roman Empire is actually a culture. It's a culture. And the all-seeing eye represents the spirit of Lucifer, you know. And there are 10 horns that arise from this world power. But anyway, back to the idea of knights. The knights of the round table were actually known as orders, you know. And the word knights, the word orders, these are all code words too. You've got the Knights Templar, which were monk soldiers or priest soldiers. And that was called an order. And other orders, like the, not the Melchizedek order, the order of Melchizedek, but that's why, that's why they call it an order, because the adversary mimics what Yahuwah has established as his priesthood. See, the Melchizedek order was the original priesthood, and it was, Adam was basically the high priest, you know, of that order. That's why Adam and Yahushua they rise up to the very top, you know, in terms of mankind and the importance of everything that's happened. Because Yahushua is really the high priest of the Melchizedek order, but he was allowing the first Adam, you know, to run that priesthood, and then he fell. But that priesthood continued, and Abraham was giving gifts of the tithe to that priest at Salem. And that was the priest of the Melchizedek order that Abraham was tithing to. It explains that in the book of Hebrews. But the Son of Man is what, or the Son of Adam, is the title that Yahushua takes, you know. I mean, you can't really ascertain that Yahushua was Adam, because, you know, they're two different people. But, you know, anyway, the Knights of the Round Table were also called orders. Anyway, other orders were are Masonic Knights. Now, the Masons have 32 levels of knights. Let's see. I think the third level of the Masonic Knights is Tubal-Cain, isn't it? I don't know. Anyway, Tubal-Cain is, you know, a heinous situation. The Illuminati Knights, the Jesuits, the Skull and Bones, they're all knights. Skull and Bones, you know. The Bohemian Lodge, the Knights of Columbus, the Knights of Malta, and many other knights, you know, their organizations. Now, here's 10 words instead of 10 horns. The retelling of the covenant for the tribes at Deuteronomy 5. I am Yahuwah, your Elohim, who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim, out of the house of bondage. You have no other mighty ones against my face. Number 2, you do not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of which is in the heavens above, or which is in the earth beneath, or which is in the waters under the earth. You do not bow down to them nor serve them. For I, Yahuwah, your Elohim, am a jealous El, visiting the crookedness of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing kindness to thousands, to those who love me and guard my commands. Okay, then. Anyway, guard and keep are the same thing. Now, number 3, you do not cast the name of Yahuwah, your Elohim, to ruin. For Yahuwah does not leave him unpunished who casts his name to ruin. Number 4, guard the Sabbath day to set it apart as Yahuwah, your Elohim, commanded you. 6 days you labor and shall do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of Yahuwah your Elohim. You do not do any work, you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor any of your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates, so that your male servant and your female servant rest as you do. And you shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Mitzrayim, and that Yahuwah your Elohim brought you out from there by a strong hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore, Yahuwah your Elohim has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. That might have been the first labor laws right there. No, number five. Respect your father and your mother as Yahuwah your Elohim has commanded you, so that your days are prolonged and so that it is well with you on the soil which Yahuwah your Elohim is giving you. Number six, you do not murder. Number seven, you do not break wedlock. Number eight, you do not steal. Number nine, you do not bear false witness against your neighbor. Number 10, you do not covet your neighbor's wife, nor do you desire your neighbor's house, his field, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, his ox, nor his donkey, or whatever belongs to your neighbor. So, it's the Torah that's to be in our hearts. And there was a man, a Christian gentleman I heard on the radio many years ago, who said it was our damnation. But I don't believe it's our damnation. The Torah is not our damnation. In fact, Proverbs 3 starts out saying, "My son, do not forget my Torah, and let your heart watch over my commands. For length of days and long life and peace they add to you. Let not kindness and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, thus finding favor and good insight in the eyes of Elohim and man. Trust in Yahuwah with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. Know him in all your ways, and he makes all your paths straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear Yahuwah, and turn away from evil. It is healing to your navel and moistening to your bones." That didn't sound like damnation. So, the message of the Besorah, the message is what the word Besorah means, is the goal. And the goal of the message is that Messiah, or Mashiach, Yahusha, be proclaimed. In Philippians 1, verse 12, it says, "And I wish you to know, brothers, that what has befallen me has turned out for the advancement of the Besorah, so that it has become known to all the palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Messiah. And most of the brothers, trusting in the Master because of my chains, are much more bold to fearlessly speak the word. Some indeed proclaim Messiah from envy and strife, but some also out of pleasure. The former announced Messiah from selfish ambition, not sincerely, thinking to add distress to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the Besorah. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Messiah is announced. And in this I rejoice. In fact, I shall rejoice." So it's a wonderful thing to see that. So when we continue on here, it moves right into Isaiah 30, starting at verse 19. "For the people shall dwell in Sion, at Jerusalem, and you shall weep no more. He will surely be gracious to you at the voice of your cry. When he shall hear, he will answer you. And though Yahuwah give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet shall not your teachers be hidden any more. But your eyes shall see your teachers, and your ears shall hear a word behind you, saying, 'This is the way, walk in it.' When you turn to the right hand and when you turn to the left." We're talking about the Torah, the instructions. Anyway, going back to the symbols of the Jesuit Illuminati that have basically sought to set their sights on conquering and ruling the world and be ultimately worshipped, because that's what they seek to do. All governments have ultimately, that become fascist or tyrannical, they ultimately get rid of all other competing deities. Now, Masonic or Illuminati Jesuit symbols are here, there, and everywhere. the fasces or the fasci, the eagle, the cross, an ancient symbol used all over the earth since ancient times. Even before history was written, the cross was the symbol for the sun. Domes, obelisks, the red cross, torch symbols, the eye on top of the pyramid, and the Caesar's laurel wreath, which is a secret emblem of world domination. Now, the millennium endgame is the United Nations New World Order. The Jesuit order, that's what they call themselves, the Jesuit order, was suppressed in the year 1773. Now, 1773 was 3 years before the Declaration of Independence for our country, but it also was 3 years before the founding of the Illuminati. Now, in 1773, a new world, the Jesuit order was suppressed, first of all, flatly suppressed. Now, then about 40 to 41 years later, the new world order was planned at the Council of Vienna in the year 1814 after Napoleon died, and a European Union was planned, which would unite all the nations of Europe. That was their first plan. And that was basically the first step in the New World Order to control the world. So some 40 years after the Jesuit order was suppressed, it was reinstated right there at the Council of Vienna in 1814. Now, it was restored and fully reinstated, and ultimately the United Nations will impose a universal currency, a rule of law, and oversee the spirituality of all mankind, which is humanism. There's an organization within the United Nations right now called the United Religions Initiative. We've talked about that too.
URI.
Yeah, URI. Yahuwah's festivals, though, his redemption plan for his wife, actually place a mark on us. We're distinctly different from those who serve the beast and the little horn. See, the little horn and the beast has been looking for us. We talked about that in the seminar on the topic of the Nazarene as heretics. They searched for us in the valleys, trying to find us, you know, in the Pasadena. The little horn attempts to change times and law and persecute the people obeying Yahuwah. So we have Pesach, or Passover, and Yahusha is our Passover. Let us keep the feast, it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8. Let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Now that's read by Christians, and I think that they miss the point that he's actually saying, let us keep the feast. You know. Anyway, reflecting back to the 10 plagues of Mitzrayim, or Egypt, we have coming right up before us a time of distress, Jacob's trouble. And the 10 plagues of Mitzrayim are reflected in the coming great tribulation. The festivals of Yahuwah reflect the protection and redemption of his people. See, back in Mitzrayim, or Egypt, the Israelites were protected from the plagues. Well, in like kind, in the very same way, By being observers of his covenant during the great distress, we will also be protected. And ultimately, we will see our redemption. The judgment of the world is the distress, and it will correspond to the 10 plagues of Egypt. In the 10th plague, Passover, it represented the judgment of Hashatan, who was represented by Pharaoh, known as the son of the sun, and his whole dominion. In other words, Satan's whole dominion was being judged at Passover. Pharaoh was considered the son of Ra, which was depicted as an eagle in a sun disk with eagle wings, or a snake, or an obelisk. The judgment was the killing of the firstborn, and all 10 plagues were judgments against Mitzrayim's principal idols. So each plague of Mitzrayim was a judgment upon one of their principal idols. The final plague the death of the firstborn manifested the weakness of Ra's son, Pharaoh. It manifested Pharaoh's weakness. In other words, Satan's weakness. The firstborn was to become the next Pharaoh. The Pharaoh's emblem was the solar eagle, Ra, which he wore on his chest. It has been used by Shaitan throughout his movements on the earth over all history. When our president stands behind his little pulpit, there's a big eagle there. That's not good. That's a bad sign. But it's all part of the symbolic program. The obelisk is another pagan Babylonian image representing both a phallus and a sun ray. Anyway, we could go through the names of these deities. H-A-P-I, the Elohim of the Nile, was water. And the next plague was against this deity, H-E-Q-T, frogs. And then we have K-H-E-P-E-R, lice and flies. And that deity was judged twice. And then we have this sacred bull called A-P-I-S, the death of the cattle. And then this deity, I-M-H-O-T-E-P, the physician, and T-H-O-T-H, magic and healing, which was manifested as boils. So the boils on the Egyptians were judging two deities. And then we have this sky deity called N-U-T, and that was the hail. And then we have the G-O-D of the crops, which was S-E-T-H, and that was the locusts. And then R-A, the sun deity, darkness. And then Pharaoh was final. He was the final one. And that was the death of the firstborn. See, even the Pharaoh's son could not be protected. But the identity of the fourth beast is also found in a number. But that number is a confusing thing, but that's because it's a riddle. In Revelation 13, starting at 18, it says, "And I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast coming up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and on his horns, 10 crowns, and on his heads, names of blasphemy. And the beast I saw was like a leopard," and that's Greece, "and his feet were like the feet of a bear," and that's Medo-Persia, "and his mouth like the mouth of a lion," that's Babel. "And the dragon gave him his power," and who's the dragon? Ashatan. "Gave him his power and his throne, and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as having been slain to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the earth marveled after the beast." And the word number, I want you to understand, can also mean not just an arithmos. In other words, not just a word for number, but also it can apply to the word group, or a quantity or cartel of people. And they worship the dragon, who gave authority to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast? Who's able to fight with him?" And he was given a mouth, speaking great matters and blasphemies, and he was given authority to do so 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemies against Elohim, to blaspheme his name and his tent and those dwelling in the heaven. And it was given to him to fight with the set-apart ones and to overcome them. And authority was given to him over every tribe and tongue and nation, and all those dwelling on the earth whose names have not been written in the book of life of the slain lamb from the foundation of the world shall worship him. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who brings into captivity shall go into captivity, and he who kills with the sword has to be killed with the sword. Here is the endurance and the belief of the set apart. That's an interesting text right there, because there's a little riddle there that's basically saying all those dwelling on the earth whose names have not been written in the scroll of life of the slain lamb from the foundation of the world shall worship him. So the ones that whose names are in the scroll of life will not worship the beast. In other words, we're not going to obey the traditions of men either. We're going to say, what does Elohim say? What does Yahuwah's word say? And we're going to live, we're going to seek that. And we're going to look for him with all our hearts, for his will, you know, to find out what it is. And that's what we're doing. You know, we're not looking for traditions. We're not being angry and rebellious against things that don't matter. But you know, the thing of it is, we will not recognize Sunday. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah. When you read 42 months, or that's what, 3.5 years, isn't it?
Yeah.
What do you think when you read that? Do you just think, oh, well, it could be anything, or?
Well, it's identifying this 70th week of Daniel, you know, as being the first half. And then the second half has been put on hold, and then the last 3.5 years will start up at some point. Mm-hmm. You know, that's basically what we understand. Of course, the key is, when do we identify the start of that? Mm-hmm. Well, these things are written down for our future identification of those events, and to reflect back on them as being almost like Yahuwah spoke it and it's going to happen. But that's all lying in his sovereignty, and I don't want to nail down anything and say, well, this is the way it is. Or, you know, those people over there are the beast. There's people that actually are teaching that Islam is the beast. Okay? And that's fine. If you can make some connections, that's fine. But it's part of the beast. That's certainly true, because it was started under the auspices and designs laid down by the Roman Empire, the Holy Roman Empire, that wanted, they had designs on Jerusalem. And they were manipulating the Arabs in order to go and run the people that were in the land out so that they wouldn't have to do it. And then they thought they were just going to waltz in there and take it, and they didn't. And that's what caused the Crusades. Mm-hmm. The Crusades came as a result of Rome discovering that the Arabs were not going to relinquish their goal. See, Satan wants to move from Rome to Jerusalem. And the Arabs now have it on their heart to make the capital of their little new organization that they have planned, Jerusalem. You know, what's the deal with this dragon?
When was the first 3.5 years of Daniel's prophecy? Was that the 3.5 years of Yahushua's ministry? When was the first 3.5 years?
Oh, that's a good question. Let's see.
I'm rusty.
It's yeah, that would be, that's what most people understand, that the first 3.5 years were, you know, during his ministry. Some people say he was only doing it for 1 year, but that doesn't work. You know, if there's people that fall for those kinds of things, but, you know, the first 3.5 years, and then the middle of the week of Daniel's week, that's a 7-year week, okay, in the middle of the week, the sacrifices were ended. Hmm. And that's because Yahushua's sacrifice ended them.
Yeah.
You know, that's it. Hmm. It's over. Hmm. All sacrifices for sin ended. Hmm. You know, oh, they continued to try, you know, but to do it. But the scapegoat's ribbon that was tied to the temple door would not change colors, and it stayed red, you know. It had been changing, and even in the Talmud, the record of the Yahudim, it says in that year that the Messiah was slain, the ribbon stopped changing colors. And there were other indications that happened. You know, the ripping of the temple's curtain was recorded also in our text and theirs, and the whole thing came to an end. Now the second half. The second half of the week are 3.5 years. And those are going to be severe, very severe. Mm. And that's what we're really reading about here, is all these hard things the things that are coming upon the earth. Mm. And it says in, continuing in this same text of let's see, where is it? Yeah, we're in Revelation, yeah. In Revelation, it continues, and it says, "And I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb and spoke like a dragon. And he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he does great signs so that he even makes fire come down from the heaven on the earth before men. And he leads astray those dwelling on the earth because of those signs, which he was given to do before the beast, saying to those dwelling on the earth to make an image or a form of the to the beast who was wounded by the sword yet lived. Now, these are, for the most part, sealed words. You know, they're riddles and symbolic language. So a lot of these words are symbols of other things. They're referring to something else. So we have to apply them as we can, you know. Anyway, it continues and says that the identity of the fourth beast is actually found in a number. Now, we know that the fourth beast is the Roman Empire. And it's a format or a culture, and it's taken over the whole world. It's already here. It's everywhere. It's every place you look. They've sent out their Jesuits. and there was given to him give spirit to the image of the beast. Now that's the form of the beast. And the image of the beast should both speak or preach and cause to be killed as many as would not worship the image of the beast. Now, the image of the beast can be an object, but it can also be the fact that the format or the form or culture of the beast is not being obeyed. And so they persecute those that don't obey the beast. Now, we know the Nazarene were pursued, and they would not worship the beast. They wouldn't bow down to the power that was resident in the authority that the Pope and his culture had. Now, and he causes all, now this is going to be really confusing, but it's meant to be, all, both small and great, and rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark upon their right hand. Now that's their actions, that's what it means, what they're doing. Or upon their foreheads, that's their thinking. And that no one should be able to buy or sell except he that has the mark, that's the actions or the ideas, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Okay, so we've got the identity of this beast we know is Roma or Rome and the culture of Rome. Now, buying and selling no one can be able to buy or sell except the one that has the mark. Now, here's wisdom. He who has understanding, let him calculate the number of the beast. For it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. And that's in the Greek that we have three letters, chi, ki, and stigma, which that'll add up to, in three, the chi is 600, and the ki is 60, and the stigma is 6. That's what's written in the text. Some texts have 616, but that's probably just mishandling of the text. But the number adds up in Roman numerals in six numbers. Now, you see the letter M for 1,000 was added in the year, in like 200 years later. They didn't even have an M in that alphanumeric system. It's a D, C, L, X, V, and I. And they equivalate, if you total up all the numbers of the Roman numeral system, they add up to 666. Because the D is 500, the C is 100, the L is 50, the X is 10, the V is 5, and the I is 1. Mm. It's right there. So that's one aspect of it, but these are riddles. But the buying and selling is not something that the beast is keeping people from buying and selling. It doesn't really say that. That's why it's a riddle. See, riddles are difficult to understand. They're little mind games, you know. Mm-hmm. Now, think about this. What would keep a person from buying or selling involving a mark or a thought or an imprint on their head, in their mind? Well, the thing that would keep us from buying and selling would be the Sabbath. It's not at all the beast. It doesn't say the beast is withholding it. It just says that no one should be able to buy and sell except he who has the mark which is Sunday. The mark of the beast is Sunday. In fact, they even say that. We'll cover that. So it isn't the beast that's keeping them from buying itself.
Mm. When you were going through those figures and looking at the Roman numerals and the Greek symbols there, Yehuchanon, who saw this vision, would have written in Hebrew, wouldn't he?
Yes, most likely.
What does that text come forward? Like, what does it mean in Hebrew? Because you don't normally put much weight on Roman or Greek
ideas. That's true. The only way to really do that is to back translate, you know.
Okay.
And I don't trust that entirely to be able to do that, because translating, especially riddles and symbolic language, we could fly around on some really weird word and come back and come up with some really crazy ideas. So when you're back translating, it's a little bit risky, not necessarily horribly risky, but when you're working with riddles and symbolic language, it can really get tricky. So I didn't pursue it. I gave it up. Yahushua's spirit in me didn't say, you know, that's what I really want you to do, Lou. It's not even for us to know. This is all going to be looked back upon anyway. But the important thing is that we be able to identify that there is a reasoning that's keeping some of these people from buying and selling. But it's not the beast. It doesn't say that the beast is doing it. It's just simply that some people are going to receive a mark that whose names were not written in the scroll of life. And the reason their names are not written in the scroll of life is because they're not obeying the Torah. And the ones that are obeying the Torah, if you just follow this riddle to its logical conclusion, the ones that obey the Torah are written in the book of life. Therefore, they're not buying and selling, you know, except on that, you know, one day. But that's the key. It leaves that part of the riddle out, but it still applies. You know, it's like if you're... there's all kinds of riddles that one can make up with coins, you know, like a quarter and a nickel, and one of them is, you know, I don't know, it's just
So but, if you don't have Yahushua's spirit, you're not really going to understand the riddles. Like when he told his parables, the crowds were baffled, and then he'd go inside and say, well, this is what it really means, you know.
That's right. Yeah, if you don't have his mind, and you know where that little trick is being played, you're not going to be able to understand it. So the man who teaches sin also is the one who changes the times and law. So the one that's teaching us to disobey the Torah, which would be the Pope and all the popes back to all the way to Constantine, who enforced the penalty of death upon those that would work on Sunday. But all we have to do is identify the fourth beast and the little horn. And we know that the fourth beast is Rome. We can be sure that this is the fourth beast, the legs of iron, which splitteth in 1054 into Eastern and Western. And it's, today it's divided into subdivided into 10 toes into the image that was seen in Nebuchadnezzar's dream. And it'll be the last beast also. And the kingdoms of mankind will abruptly end with the return of Yahushua. Because in Daniel's vision, the dream that he interpreted for Nebuchadnezzar, this great stone came out of the sky, and that's the rock, and it came and struck the image of men's kingdoms in the toes, and the whole thing collapsed and blew away, and there was nothing found, no remnant of it. And the little horn is identified as the anti-Messiah, and it is the seat where the residence of Hashatan resides. And it's the same as the woman that's sitting on the beast, reigning over the kings of the earth.
That'd be the part.
So, ultimately, yeah. And all you have to do is just look around the world and say, well, where would that be? Let me see. Oh, look at these gentlemen here. What are they doing? Well, let's look at the worship of the little horn right here in some of these images. The vicar, the replacement for Messiah, is visited by every world leader. And every time they visit this man of sin, this one that teaches to sin, they pay homage to the power that resides in him. And we could go endlessly with photographs of that, you know. So this false prophet, this little horn, secular and spiritual ruler of all the earth, has the hat of D-A-G-O-N on his head. And he sits in the throne of Hashatan. And he was given the throne and great power by the dragon. And what is interesting, too, is in the Jesuits' mindset, individual freedom of conscience is abhorrent to them and this ruler. And only his authority is legitimate. And all the kings of the earth are as altar boys to do his bidding. And behind his power is the prince of darkness, the controller follows. The new superior general of the Jesuits, as of the first Roman month in 2008, succeeding the Dutch Peter Hans Kolvenbach, this guy named Father Adolfo Nicholas Pacan, Society ASU. They put an SJ after their name as a title because they're a member of that order. He's the new Spanish Superior General of the Society of ASU, or the Society of JES, JESUS. The Sons of Loyola. And this organization, Society ASU, also is called Regimini Militantis Ecclesiae, or Ecclesiae. And that is Latin for the government of the church, or the circus militant. Excuse me. So anyway, this fellow named Adolfo Nicholas Pacan speaks five languages, Spanish, Japanese, English, French, and Italian. And he wears this seal of the Jesuits right there emblazoned, and it's right there on his chest. It looks like a sun. Wonder why that would be. Can't imagine. And he's got these letters, IHS, which are the three deities of Egypt. I don't want to say them, but this pallium was a thing that the priests of the pagans wore all the time because sex was what their objective was, and that's actually a garment that is worn to depict power and authority. And its design is based upon the ancient Egyptian Ankh, which itself represents sexual intercourse. And by extension, it represents life. See, sexual intercourse represented life. And the symbol of the Ankh was that ancient symbol used for that purpose. So the culture of Rome is the fourth beast. And with this identification made, we can now look within this beast system, or Rome, to find the woman sitting upon or controlling or restraining it. And this woman is the mother circus who rules over the kings of the earth. Within her is the Jesuit network, and within them is the power source, the prince of darkness. And anyway, the Jesuits control the world systems primarily through banking. Because if you can get control of a nation's currency, then you don't care who their rulers are. I think there was a banker named Warburg that's quoted saying that, or something like it. And the Jesuit Illuminati is synonymous with this organization. And Hashatan, which is the eye on the top of the pyramid, is the entity within their society. See, the Jesuits are behind the formation of the United Nations and the Council on Foreign Relations, and the Club of Rome, the Bilderberger Organization, and all those are all basically the same network. And this network that fomented the ability to form the United Nations has all these world systems in place. The World Health Organization, the World Banking. The World Bank is the network of all the Federal Reserve systems. And they tried to assassinate many of our presidents. They succeeded in assassinating many of them. Abraham Lincoln being one of them, because he didn't want anything to do with the Federal Reserve system. Mm-hmm. And that control of the money was their primary concern. Mm-hmm. The mark of the authority of the beast is given to it by the dragon. Now, the mark of authority, what is that? It's calling it a mark. The mark of the beast. Okay. The Catholic Circus confirms through many statements that she has a mark. And here's what we read in one place. Quote, Sunday is our mark of authority. The circus, and I'm using that word in place of the word C-H-U-R-C-H, is above the B-I-B-L-E. And this transference of Sabbath observance to Sunday is proof of that fact. Now, another statement says, of course, the Catholic Circus claims that the change was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical authority in religious things. Now, when did Yahuwah ever use a prophet to prophesy that he was going to change his Sabbath? It didn't ever happen. Something that critical? Now, it's a sign forever, it says in Exodus 31. Verse 15 says, 6 days work is done, and on the seventh is a Sabbath of rest, set apart to Yahuwah. Everyone doing work on the Sabbath day shall certainly be put to death, and the children of Israel shall guard the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. Between me and the children of Israel, it is a sign forever. For in 6 days, Yahuwah made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. See, it flies in the face of what we just read the Catholics themselves wrote. And Ezekiel 20 says it's a sign too. And I gave them, in Ezekiel 20, verse 11, and I gave them my laws and showed them my right rulings, which if a man does, he shall live by them. And I also gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between them and me to know that I am Yahuwah, who sets them apart. That's a wonderful thing. But the day that's not blessed, and yet is stated to be the mark of the authority of the beast, the mark of the authority of the beast, is Sunday. So, there it is.
That's the religious day.
Yeah, the fourth beast has got most of the world blinded. And when I realized that I had been in transgression of Yahuwah's laws in that one thing, and I started to do a little research on that. This reveals the fourth beast more than any other single thing. You know, because you can't bend the days of the week. The adversary has been trying to bend that thing. Get that week out of there. The week is everywhere. And the seventh day of the week is the same all around the world. It's just a matter of identifying which day you're supposed to rest. Islam abandoned it, and if the Sabbath is not really the Sabbath, why would Hashatan move it to Sunday? You know, so the Sabbath must be real. You know, even though the lunar Sabbathers would like it not to be.
So anybody watching this who goes, oh, Sunday is the mark of the beast, but Lou puts his seminars on a Sunday, isn't he, like everybody else in religion?
Well, I'm going back to work. See, when Yahusha resurrected, it was sometime at the end of the Sabbath day when sun was setting. Of course, some people agree with that either, but anyway, he came out of the tomb and he was going back to work first day of the week. You know, see, in his body that he has now, his resurrected body, he doesn't need to sleep. He doesn't need to eat, although he can. He doesn't need to. We will have that kind of energy too. Moshe, when he was in the presence of the Shekinah, was not, you know, the presence of the name. That's what Shekinah really means, the nesting or the presence. Which the next seminar I'll be on, I'm going to hope, Yahuwah willing, tomorrow. The presence of Yahuwah's Shekinah, the energy that was flowing, the life and power that was emanating from the Shekinah, it allowed Moshe not to have to eat or sleep. I mean, think of the work you can get done. You're just sitting there going, wow, I'm so full of power. I don't even have to, I'm not even thirsty anymore. I don't have to eat. I don't have to sleep. He didn't have to do a thing.
Oh, wonderful.
It's amazing. And it's just something to contemplate. But when he came down from that mountain, Moshe, having been in the presence, was glowing himself. You know, they had to put something over him to kind of keep that down a little bit. Yeah.
They didn't have sunglasses back then.
No, they didn't. But, you know, I had a picture taken of me one time, and it had this giant glow above the head. And I was, what in the world caused that? You know, and I thought, that might have been the Shekinah. You know, I don't know. They caught it on like on one of these special films.
Yeah.
No. It was some club picture I have for a little place where Phyllis and I shop. And we have to be members, and we show them this card. We have to have a photo ID.
Mm-hmm.
It's a silly picture. I have to make a copy of it and show you.
Yeah. Oh, you're in trouble now. We appreciate all your emails.
Yeah, they're going to be really.
Yeah.
They're going to be mad now.
Yeah. Oh, dear.
Hey, we've been doing it for 2 hours.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, in case we don't touch on it again, I just remembered just before you were talking about the URI, the United Religions, is it, initiative? And you touched on that in a seminar that really, I don't think it came out very well, called pluralism. What's pluralism? It's very relevant for today, for people to understand what pluralism is.
Yeah, pluralism is basically the idea that it doesn't really matter. We should be accepting of all beliefs of other. In fact, just accept everybody as they are in their error, as if that doesn't matter anymore. But Yahuwah is not a pluralist. He's not thinking, oh, well, you know, whatever you were thinking, that's fine. We'll just do that. Yahuwah is very exclusive, and he's just the opposite of that. His nature, his character, precludes any false worship. When a person, even when Aharon's sons came and they felt great zeal in their heart for Yahuwah, and they offered a strange fire to him that was not commanded, he struck them. The Shekinah shot out and consumed them, struck them down like lightning, you know. And said, you know, basically that was a statement that you don't mess around with this stuff. So if you want to toy with pluralism and say, well, I've studied all these religions and I accept them all, there's a big mistake being made. You know, you can't accept Buddhism and things that are wrong with Christianity and then worship Yahuwah by walking in his commandments. You can't do it all together. You have to just worship him and him only, you know. And he, you know, otherwise you're going to be in for a big surprise, a giant shock, because Yahusha will say, I never knew you. Away from me, you who practice lawlessness, you know.
Yeah.
And we want to make sure that we're not doing that. But pluralism is the idea of being more than one, you know, accepting and adopting traditions and spiritualism, or spiritual practices.
Amazing.
Has anything been fading in and out here?
It just started to about a minute ago, but the whole time's been great. Yeah. Maybe the camera's getting tired. Yeah.
Or maybe I'm getting tired and I'm starting to come apart into a gas.
Your Shekinah's starting to get in the way.
Well,
yeah.
Actually, the Shekinah is in all of us in a small way, because we understand that Shekinah is literally the nesting of his name. The dwelling place is what it is related to. In fact, the Hebrew word Mishkan, yeah, is the word for temple or dwelling place. Mishkan is based on the same root as Shekinah. It means the dwelling place of his name, Shekinah. You know, Shekinah. And you can hear Mishkan, you know, It's right there. If you just say Ishkan, and then look at it, and then Shekinah. It's amazing. So he's in us. If he's put his name in us, then we are like the tongues of fire that were like they were like tongues of light that descended upon the 120 Nazarene. That was the Shekinah.
Wow.
And there's many other examples.
That's amazing, brother. What a blowout.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Well, it's lovely seeing you, mate, again.
Same here. Yeah, we got to talk two weeks in a row. Well, one week. Yeah. It was great doing it last week and then this week. Wasn't it just last week?
Yeah, it was last week. Yeah. I'm trying to get these things together before we end up hitting the road in a caravan, it'll make my job a bit harder. So if we can get this done now, it'll be great.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
All right. Well, I guess we'll put an end to this. And then what's the next plan? Do you have a plan?
Well, the last two on the DVD we haven't covered is the two witnesses and the second Exodus. So we can pick up on that next week.
Okay. Are you going to do both? You want to do both of those together?
We don't have to, but I've kind of got to shorten them a little bit because we've got the two resurrections on the same disc. So, and we don't want to cut too much out of that one because it's amazing, vital. So,
okay.
If we can, whereas if you think there's too much in there, we can just do. Two sessions. I don't mind.
Okay. We might do two more. Yeah.
Okay. We've also covered a lot of Yuhukin on our Patmos with Love show as well. So we don't really have to do that there. We enjoy the rest of your Sabbath, mate.
All right. I'll see you then next week. Then let's do it. You want to do it next week?
Sounds great to me.
Okay. Well, we'll see you then.
Love you, mate.
All right. Love you. Bye bye.
Bye bye. We'll be right back.
witchcraft happening here? Why it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a tree over their hair. Other times he's dressed up to scare. And it's strange, so deranged. Wake me up, give me a pinch. The dragon soldier's getting rich. The truth is laying in a ditch. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Must be the season of the witch. Must be the season of the witch. Must be the season of the witch. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Pagan feasts don't be long. Nobody's right if everyone's wrong. In their minds, they're never taught to love and be kind, and it's strange, need to change. Oh, wake me up, give me a pinch, the dragon soldier's getting rich, the truth is slain in the dead. Getting rich. The truth is laying in a ditch.